Hi. I want to welcome you on a journey to discover the unique but troublesome world of the Baltic Sea. The Baltic Sea is dear to me. It's always been part of my life. I was born on its shores. I learned to swim in its waves. I've been paddling and sailing through it, skiing on its icy surface, and gone diving in its depths. Over the course of my life, I've seen it change. And today, my sea is one of the most polluted in the world. In less than 100 years, we have transformed this healthy, clear body of water into a murky green sea, with nothing but a shadow of its previous glory. Can you imagine that less than 100 years ago, there used to be so many harbor porpoises that they were swimming even to rivers in Finland? Or that cod, which is now a symbol of the effects of overfishing, used to be so plentiful that it was commonly caught throughout the Baltic Sea. But early in my career, I wanted to solve environmental problems that were far away. I was interested in saving the rainforests and safeguarding tropical coral reefs. But the further I went, the more I was driven back to the Baltic Sea. And soon I realized that if I fail to tackle this environmental disaster here, in my own backyard, who am I to tell advice to others? The Baltic Sea is truly one of its kind. And we, especially those of us living on its shores, can't afford to lose it. It's too precious. I believe we can change it for better. To do that, we need to understand this sea, the threats that it faces, and the solutions it needs. So let's start with the basics. With 3,500 years old, the Baltic Sea is young. It is almost completely enclosed and surrounded 9 countries. 85 million people live in its catchment area. The catchment area is the area of land from which the water from melting snow, rain and rivers drain into it. In this case, it is about 4 times larger than the sea itself, meaning that pollution flowing into it can originate from far, hundreds of kilometers away, and even from countries that don't border the sea. Later today, you will learn more about this when you listen to a talk about Vistula River. That is one of the major rivers flowing to the Baltic. With the mean depth of 55 meters and its deepest point at about 450 meters, the Baltic Sea is not only young, but it's also small. Sorry, the Baltic Sea is not only small, but it's also shallow. And what's more, because it is connected to the oceans only via the narrow and shallow Danish Straits, it takes more than 30 years for the whole water volume of the Baltic to refresh itself. Can you imagine that Baltic Sea catches a breath only twice in your lifetime? This makes Baltic Sea very vulnerable to accumulation of pollution. Another unique attribute of this sea is that it is also one of the world's largest bodies of brackish water, made up of a mixture of salty water from North Sea and fresh water from inland. Its salinity stays generally low, but it varies throughout the area and with the depth. Because of these unique characteristics, the ecosystems of the Baltic Sea are what we call simple. It means that there is only a limited number of species, sometimes only one, serving one particular function in the ecosystem. And if this species disappears, it may cause irreversible damage to the entire system, as there may not be other species having the same ecological requirements. This makes the Baltic Sea very fragile and very vulnerable to human-caused stress, of which there are many types. Land-based activities, including agriculture, traffic, housing and industry, result in pollutants that are entering the sea as a runoff from land via the rivers or the atmosphere. Other destructive activities include coastal and offshore installations, extraction of materials from the seabed, like sand and gravel, intensive shipping, and unsustainable fisheries as well, which I'll go more into depth about later, as it is the second largest problem faced by the Baltic Sea. But to cut a long story short, because of these activities, there are high concentrations of toxins in the water that are accumulating in the food web, harming marine life, and making some fish unsafe for human consumption. So you see, there is always a boomerang effect that will hunt on us. But arguably, the most important consequence of our activities is that the Baltic Sea is badly eutrophied. Eutrophication is a status where the sea is getting too much of a good thing, in this case nutrients, namely nitrogen and phosphorus that are loaded to the sea. While you may not all have heard of the term, you have certainly seen it in effect. The massive algae blooms that gives the Baltic Sea its infamous green and murky tint and reduced visibility. During the big blooms, the whole main basin of the Baltic Sea turns green, as in the satellite image. And if any one of you have been diving in the Baltic Sea, you know that at times it can be quite a claustrophobic experience. I have gotten used to the warning signs on beaches every summer, alerting me not to go swimming because of the toxic algae in the water. And while it might be inconvenient for me not being able to swim, under the waves it is a matter of life and death. Because the increased toxicity and reduced visibility are not the only consequence of these blooms. They also alter the ecosystems. In this photo, you can see a healthy meadow of a bladderwrack. It is one of the most important species of the Baltic Sea, serving as important feeding, breeding, and spawning place for a number of other species. The extra amounts of nutrients loaded to the sea causes overgrowth of other algae that suffocates and ultimately kills off the bladderwrack and the species depending on it. At worst, eutrophication gets so bad that oxygen is completely sucked out of the water, creating dead zones where no life can survive. The situation today is worse than ever. Over 20% of the Baltic Sea lack enough oxygen to contain life, and this is the highest record since the 60s. To put this on perspective, let's bring it above ground. On land, this would mean that when driving from Warsaw to Brussels, you would see nothing but dead smelly mud. And I bet, if this happened on land, people would be outraged. But because it is under the waves and out of sight, it's out of mind. And then there is overfishing. Over the past 50 years, we've been overfishing and fishing down the food web, meaning that the appearance of large predatory fish, such as cod and salmon in the Baltic Sea, have decreased. Worldwide, the big fish have dropped by 90%. I love the Finnish archipelago sea. I think it is one of the most beautiful places on Earth. I've spent numerous summer holidays there. I've been biking through the small islands and spent months working in there. It could be a true paradise, but there is something severely wrong in the picture. It is difficult, almost impossible, to find fresh local fish for sale. Instead, you get farmed salmon coming either by nearby fish farms or often as far as from Norway. But it is not the matter of overfishing. It is also a matter of types of gear we use to catch the targeted species. Bottom trawling is a method that is used mainly to target cod in the Baltic, but also herring in the north. While this picture here is not from the Baltic Sea, but it illustrates you what happens with the bottom trawling. It involves tracking heavy dors across the seabed, ripping up and destroying everything in its way. As you can imagine, this is particularly harmful for slow-growing and immobile species. It can take dozens of years, if not longer, for some species and habitats to recover. And in some areas, they never will. Trawling also stirs up hazardous substances that are stored in the sediments, that then re-enter the water column and the food chain, worsens eutrophication by creating more algae blooms and dead bottoms. So it doesn't sound good, does it? And it's true. Baltic Sea is in big trouble. I have taken part on expeditions throughout the Baltic Sea. We've been gathering information about the status of the ecosystems. Our recordings show unusual high numbers of sick and injured fish. This has been experienced also by some others, as recent news from Sweden tell that the coastal ecosystem is changing, and the fishermen are witnessing the same as I have. Also, the fish are moving out and into deeper waters. The exact causes of this have yet to be investigated, but it shows that the ecosystem health status of the Baltic Sea is bad, and that we may be witnessing changes that, at worst, are irreversible. To change this situation, to get more green and blue color on this map, we need action from all fronts. On land, we are far more advanced in protecting the wildlife. So why do we allow unsustainable practices to continue at sea? We should be applying the same effort and logic to the sea as we do on land. We need to change the path we are on, simply because we cannot afford the consequence of not acting. Baltic Sea is much more valuable to us when it is restored and protected. It helps regulate climate and circulate water. It controls pollution and maintains biodiversity. The Baltic Sea is of enormous social, cultural, and economic importance to the countries that border it. Holiday activities, including swimming, fishing, and sailing, coexist with commercial fishing and industrial activities. We cannot afford to sit by and do nothing. Because saving this sea should be nowhere near impossible. After all, we are living in countries that are among the richest on Earth. If we fail to tackle this environmental disaster here, how can we expect poorer countries to do so? So here's what needs to happen. First of all, there is already a number of political, regional, European and global-wide decisions in place aiming at safeguarding and restoring the Baltic Sea. But those need to be properly implemented in order to see the positive change. Targeting eutrophication should be the focal point of our efforts, as it will lead to diminished pressure on biodiversity and enhance the overall resilience of the ecosystems to cope with unexpected events like climate change. So reducing the amounts of nutrients is the prerequisite. There is a positive example on this, showing that it can be done, because the amounts of hazardous substances have already dropped since the worst years. And a bit over a year ago, in the Gulf of Finland, a big source of phosphorus was blocked. And already now, we are witnessing that the oxygen content and the phosphorus levels in the water are healthier. To tackle fisheries, we need to move towards low-impact gear and favor small artisanal fleets over the large industrial ones. We need to manage the fisheries in a way that we leave enough big fish to reproduce. Now, many of the fish are caught so small that they barely get to reproduce even once in their lifetime. But here again, we have some positive news, showing that it can be done. More stringent quotas for the Eastern Baltic cod have proven to be efficient. Past years are showing signs that cod is returning to the Baltic Sea. The stock has increased. Safeguarding the diversity of nature is the health insurance for the Baltic Sea. That's why we also need well-managed marine protected areas to maintain and restore the damaged ecosystems. No-take marine reserves, for instance, also called as fish recovery areas, are home to fish that are significantly bigger and more plentiful than outside their boundaries. And as fish gets bigger and more productive inside the protected area, that spills over to those unprotected surroundings, leading also for bigger catches for fishermen. About 12% of the Baltic Sea is currently covered with marine protected areas. And this is a quite impressive figure, considering that worldwide, only less than 1% of marine waters are protected. But the problem is that marine protected areas only work when they are properly managed. And unfortunately, this is not the case in the Baltic Sea, where the areas are often poorly regulated and rarely inspected. Even bottom trawling is allowed inside marine protected areas. I work in a project that aims to provide solutions to some of these troubles faced by the Baltic Sea. By doing at-sea expeditions, we are gathering information and evidence, we propose new marine protected areas and better management practices for the existing ones and for fisheries. But you too, you can also do your share by affecting your own life. Because after all, major changes are often created by millions of smaller choices. We all eat, for instance. So what we eat really matters, not only to us, but also to the environment. With fish, you should favor sustainably caught species. And as agriculture produces over 50% of the nutrients flowing to the sea, favoring organic products can help in curbing the nutrient runoff. But most importantly, it is important to reduce the amount of waste you reproduce and recycle your leftovers. So you see, while it does seem an overwhelming task to repair this sea of troubles, it certainly isn't hopeless. Not nearly. This patient is not dead yet. So it's time to leave the doomsday predictions behind and concentrate on solving the troubles. The positive examples show that it is possible. There is light at the end of the tunnel. It can be done. I have a 5-year-old daughter. And in 30 years from now, when she reaches my age, I dream that she too is able to tell a story about the Baltic Sea and how she saw it change over the course of her life. But I dream that the story she tells is the opposite of mine. I hoped that the change she witnesses is for better. Thank you very much.